Real quick, what I'm going to be doing here is actually going through a demonstration as opposed to doing going through slides or doing a presentation. So it'll be a demo, and essentially what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through the quick start guide for our iOS SDK, and I'm going to show you how you can quickly get up and running with a mobile application using Gimbal's SDK and our Bluetooth proximity beacons. And so without further delay, I'll first direct you to, actually, I'll give a high level of where I'm going to be jumping through three essentially different windows on my screen. And I'm assuming everyone can see my screen. I'm sharing my desktop. And again, Laura, I just want to confirm that you can see gimbal.com's website, which is up on my screen right now.
Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to jump between our developer portal, which is required for the setting up of the platform, and I'm going to jump between that and Xcode, which is where I will launch the actual demonstration app from. And then on the right-hand side of my screen is QuickTime, which is mirroring my actual device. So I'm going to use my actual iOS device to do the demonstration, which you're seeing one of my home screens here on the right-hand side. Okay, so you can follow along on this. It's pretty straightforward. The quick start is intended for any developers to be able to kind of get up and running with Gimbal. So the only caveat to that is that you do need a developer account. So from Gimbal's homepage, up in the top right, there's a developer login, and if you click on that, you'll land in the Gimbal Manager login, and if you do not yet have a login, there's a register button, and by filling in this form and agreeing to the developer agreement, you'll then have an account that you could use to follow along. The other thing that I'll be using that you may not have available are the actual Bluetooth beacons. You can buy these in our store, but we don't have 5-minute delivery, so if you don't have them, you won't have them in time for this demonstration. But what you can do, and I'll show you how to do it, is use a geofence rather than a beacon to essentially do the same demonstration that we're about to do. But you can go to store.gimbal.com to purchase the beacons that I'm going to be using in this demo. Okay, so once you have your login in the Gimbal Manager, you'll sign in. Similar to, for instance, Apple's developer site, your user account may belong to multiple organizations. So I'm going to log into my demo organization, which is what we're going to be using for this demonstration. So in the developer portal, this is the home screen. On the home screen, there's some messages here that we'll get rid of. There's a link right in the middle of the screen to the quick start guide. And so we're going to walk through this quick start guide. Ahead and give that a click, and the next step is for you to choose a platform that you want to use to progress through the quick start. We're going to use iOS in this case. It's essentially the same thing for Android. Okay, so once you've chosen your platform, the next thing you're going to do is create what we call a gimbal, a place. And a place is just a generic term for either a geofence or a Bluetooth beacon. In this case, I'm going to use a beacon. The beacon allows me to demonstrate essentially arrivals and departures to a place by powering the beacon on and off, which is what we're going to do in this demonstration. I'm going to call my place AT&T demo beacon, so it's clear what we're interacting with. Okay, so our beacons have on the physical piece of hardware what we call a factory ID. You see a picture of that over here on the right-hand side. This is what the actual label looks like. And this, in this example, 1C34-5A789 is the factory ID, which you would need to activate this beacon in the system. The actual beacon that I have sitting in front of me, this is its factory ID. So I'm going to activate that beacon. So I now have a place represented by that beacon in the system. The next thing I'm going to do is download the sample app from GitHub. This is a public GitHub project that you can get to, but is not necessarily usable without a developer account. So you have to do both. So I'll download that sample application from GitHub into a zip file, which we just did here. You see that zip in the lower right. And then we're going to want to unzip that and open that in Xcode. So if I open that archive, you'll see an Xcode project in there. And we're going to launch that Xcode project and open Xcode. Okay, so now the three screens that we're jumping between are going to be Xcode, which you're looking at. We're interested in these Xcode windows. I'm going to make it slightly smaller so we can also see my phone here on the right-hand side. And we're going to jump back to the developer portal. So we've downloaded the sample app from GitHub and we launched it in Xcode. The next step is to create what we call an application in the management platform. And what that's going to do is create, so you can use the default here. It fills in the default information that you need for that sample application, and you just hit create here. What it'll do essentially is create the API key that you're going to need to insert into your application to enable the SDK. So there's a copy button there to be able to copy that API key. And basically the last step is to actually download our SDK from the website. You can download it through the Quick Start on the left-hand side here in the navigation under SDK downloads. So you can go here to get the iOS or Android version at any time. We need to unzip and navigate into the actual framework in that SDK. It's called gimbal.framework. And in Xcode, if I expand my project view here on the left-hand side, there's a frameworks group inside of Xcode. And what we want to do is we want to take this gimbal.framework, we want to move it into the frameworks of my sample application. Make sure this copy items, if needed, is checked, and then just click finish. And you'll see now the Gimbal framework is included in my sample application. So if we jump back to the Quick Start guide and hit next, the next step, and we kind of jumped over this copying the API key. I did not yet insert it into my app, which I'll do right now. So inside of the viewcontroller.m file, you see right at the top, there's this string that says your API key here, where I need to paste my Gimbal API key into for this application. Okay, so pasting in my API key and including the framework essentially sets up this demonstration app to be runnable on a device. So my phone is plugged in via USB, and it's being recognized up here by Xcode as available as a target for my app. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to run this, and the app's going to get launched, and we're going to be able to see that here in the mirroring on the right-hand side. So run the app, and we'll come back to Xcode and look a little bit at the code that's required for the integration. As soon as we have it up and running, we can demonstrate that it's working. So the first thing you're seeing here is iOS permissions for location in the background. We do want that enabled. iOS gives you the ability to set a string for your application to describe to users why they would want to allow this. So depending on what you're using Gimbal for in your app features, you would put something appropriate. So I'll click on Allow for Locations. The other thing that we'll demonstrate here, not immediately but a little later on, is how to deliver notifications based on the place events that we're about to see. And so I'm gonna agree to those permissions as well so we can demonstrate that later. So now you're just seeing a blank list. So the app is running. The piece that you're not gonna be able to see here is me powering up an actual Bluetooth beacon. But I'm gonna do that. So I'm turning our Bluetooth beacon on, and it's in pairing mode for about 10 seconds. And as soon as it's out of pairing mode, you should see what we just saw on the screen. So it's actually, this beacon is had just delivered an event to the SDK, and it's putting it in the list. So there was the beginning of what we call a visit to a place, and it's the beacon that we created in the manager called AT&T Demo Beacon. And here's just the date and timestamp when that event occurred. And so, okay, two things I'm going to do here. I'm going to power the beacon off, and I'm going to, while we wait for this to depart, we're going to navigate back into Xcode. So we're going to see two things here. We're going to see that based on an interval of not seeing the beacon, the SDK will deliver another event. So we'll begin and end here in a minute. And it's the absence of seeing the beacon, so there's some period of time where we want to leave that before we actually deliver the event to the application, and it's set by default for 30 seconds. It's actually configurable, but that's this end event that just happened. So I powered the beacon off, and I got an event, hey, my device doesn't see the beacon anymore, I've left it. So we have two events here. And so let's jump back into Xcode and take a look at what actually happened. My view controller is just a list controller and is a delegate to Gimbal's place manager. And so let's see what we did. We called Gimbal and set our API key on line 16. We created an instance of a place, what we call a place manager in the application, in this view controller for our application, and set ourselves as a delegate. This allows for the callbacks to the delegate. And then I'm telling Gimbal, start monitoring places, essentially, on line 20. The other thing that we'll get to in a second is I also turned on what we call a communication manager in Gimbal to receive communications, which essentially is like a lightweight wrapper around platform notifications. So we can receive notifications for these events that we receive in the application. And then the other two key pieces of code here are the delegate callbacks for our place manager. So the Gimbal place manager has three delegate methods, two of which we've enabled inside of this application. All three are optional, but the ones that are enabled are the begin of a visit to a place and the ending of a visit to a place. So in this case, what we did was we're printing in the log, which you can see down here at the bottom of the screen. We're printing the description of this Gimbal visit into the log. I'm sorry, we're printing the description of the actual place attached to that visit in the log. And then we are also inserting this place information into the actual view, the list view, which is actually what we're seeing inside the app. This is the list view, and this is us attaching these table view items into the app right here on line 37 for the arrival, and then, I'm sorry, line 37 was for the departure or the ending of the visit. The beginning of the visit, same exact thing. When the visit began, we did the same thing. We put the information about that place into the table. So, okay. At this point, we have integrated with a beacon as a place, and we have an app now that can deliver events to us based on that. The other thing that we can do, if it fits our use case, is I'm going to navigate back into the Gimbal Manager. And I'm going to show you the quick start, what the quick start actually did under the hood for us real quick. It created this application, what we call an application here, which created the API key for us to put into the application. It created a place called the AT&T Demo Beacon, which the events came from inside the application, the arriving at and departing from the beacon. And that place is represented by the physical beacon, which we activated as part of the quick start. So So places can be represented, like we said in the beginning, by beacons and geofences. So if you don't have a beacon and you want to kind of recreate this demo, what you can do is create a new place. We're going to call this AT&T demo geofence. And we're going to create a new geofence. I'm going to create San Diego. This is my current location. So what I want to do is I want to create a geofence around my current location. And not exactly where it's showing here on the map. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to drag this over to where I am. I'm actually a little further up the street. I'm right here. So what I've done here is I've created a geofence around my current location. And I'm going to go ahead and create that place. And so now on my gimbal places, I have two. I have one place that represents a beacon and one that represents a geofence. So now what we're going to do, geofences are a little harder to demonstrate. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to go back. I'm going to uninstall the application. So that it picks up. Stop that without stopping it in Xcode. So now we're fine. Quit out of there. So now I'm back in Xcode. And I'm going to run this app again. You're going to see that on the right hand side of my screen. What's going to end up happening here, once I allow location, it's going to recognize that I'm inside of that geofence already. As that initialized, it picked up the geofences off the server and recognizes that I'm there. So we have places. We have place events. For me to actually leave this geofence, I would have to move essentially a couple hundred meters from where I am right now, so we're not going to be able to demonstrate that, but you can use geofences and you can run the demonstration app without the beacons, which is what I wanted to demonstrate here. The next thing that I want to demonstrate is what we call gimbal communications, which are essentially just lightweight wrappers around notifications on the platform and the ability to have notifications triggered by our place events. So there's two things I'm going to need to do. First, I need to actually create a communicate. So if we go to the communicate tab in Manager on the left, and then we click new communication, we land on a screen that looks like this. There's about five or six mandatory fields. One is the name of your communicate, which we're just going to call AT&T communicate. We're going to start that today. We'll let it be valid for 1 week. Then when the user arrives at any of my places, we'll do the beacon in this case, you can do user arrives, user departs, the time of the day, or fetching it the communicate by attributes as the triggers to delivering this communicate to the device. Then the place, because I picked arrival, user arrives, I can pick a specific place, or I can say any or all of my places. My user arrives at any one of my places. I want this to be delivered. In this case, we're just going to use the beacon. There's some frequency and delay settings here. We're going to leave those alone at this point. And then we're going to say hello as a title and hello to thack as our description, and what you'll see, scroll a little more down, in iOS, which is what we're using, only the description becomes valid as the message. On the Android platform, the title and the description are both visible. iOS's notification system only supports a single string as the message, so that's why we're using only the description of this communicator. Okay, so we'll save and publish this. And so now we have a communicate that will trigger when I arrive at my beacon. The other thing that I need to do to kind of make this demonstration interesting to you would be to, hey, deliver a notification even if the app is not in the background, right? My user is probably not walking around with my application open, but I want them to know that they're near my beacon. So in that scenario, I need Bluetooth accessories to be, the background mode for Bluetooth accessories to be enabled. So you'll see that by choosing my app target and enabling the background mode uses Bluetooth LE accessories, it will actually recognize the Bluetooth device in the background. Everything else stays the same, and the app's already running. So I'm sorry, the app's already running, but the app did not have that permission when I installed it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop the app, and I'm going to reinstall it so that permission gets sent down to my actual device. So on the right-hand side, we're seeing my device again. I'm going to reinstall the app on here. So here we go. It's a new fresh installation, so I'm going to allow location in the background. I'm going to allow notifications. We arrive at the geofence, just like last time, like we expected. The beacon's not powered on. So what I'm going to do, before I power the beacon on, I'm actually going to put the app in the background so that we can see. Once I do arrive at the beacon, even though the app's in the background, I should still receive the platform notification, which is what you just saw at the top of the screen. So my app, and I actually have two apps on this device that recognize this beacon, so that was the second one you're seeing. So we pull down notifications. This second one in the list, Hello Gimbal iOS, is our demo app. I'll click that. It'll launch the app, and it'll show me that I've arrived at the beacon. You can actually have a notification do pretty much anything you want within the application once it's delivered to the app. We're just having it launch the list view again. Okay. So we covered, I'm back in the Gimbal Manager. We covered creating an application so that you can get your API key. We covered places represented as beacons and geofences and how you can deliver events based on those in the demo application, and what a communicate is and how you would enable that within the app. So they're pretty much the topics I want to discover to cover in this. It was a lot, and so I want to leave time now. I'm going to go ahead and begin accepting questions, and we can delve more into the code. We can do whatever the questions relate to. We can revisit that. So let's see if I can figure out how to get to the Q&A. Okay, here we go. So I'm bringing up the Q&A, and then I'll open it up, and I'll try to answer anyone's questions that they have at this point.
So we've had a couple questions come in, if you don't mind me moderating a bit. They asked for the link to the GitHub code.
Okay, perfect.
Put that in the chat box to all the participants.
Absolutely. Okay, so I'll navigate to it in my browser. So on GitHub, our organization is called Gimbal Inc. in GitHub. So if we navigate there, there's actually three sample apps here, one on iOS, for one in Objective-C on iOS, which is the one that we just used. There's also a Swift version of that, and then there's the same demo app but on Android available there as well. So the one that we just did was Objective-C iOS. I'm going to copy that link, and I'm going to put it into our chat. The features are at parity, so everything that we just did on iOS, we can also do on Android. And that SDK is also available on the website. I will jump back on my screen into the Gimbal Manager. I'll click SDK downloads, and you'll see the iOS SDK and the Android SDK both available here, the latest versions. So hopefully that answers that question. Do the beacons support Eddystone? The beacons can be, the beacons in the very near future, I don't have a date for you at this second, in the very near future you will be able to reprogram these beacons as Eddystone. So the answer to that is yes, soon. And then another question from Penelope, if pictures are changed, is it also automatically updated? So when we say pictures, I'm not exactly sure. Penelope, I'm not exactly sure what you are referring to. You say pictures are changed, is it automatically updated? The Communicate lets you set up a URL that you can launch when the Communicate is delivered to the application. If you update that URL, anytime an event happens for any place that you've used to trigger that Communicate, we'll receive the latest URL. I imagine that maybe is what this is referring to. If not, go ahead and type the question in again, and I'll try to answer it.
And any more questions?
Oh, okay, here we go. I didn't see that there were more. Okay, pictures. To register the beacons, if you give an option to assign a picture. Oh, the icon. Yeah, we deliver also a URL to the icon. That is cached on the device, so those changes won't be picked up immediately. The interval at which that would get updated on the device varies to some extent. Generally, it will be an average of 30 minutes before your application would actually recognize the change on the server. So it would get updated, but it wouldn't be real time. There's potentially, on average, I would say a 30-minute delay before that would get picked up. So I hope that answers that question. Then Dawn asked a question about server rules. Okay, server rules relate to the beacons specifically and the ability for our server to generate events similar to what we're generating on the SDK, but from our server to post them to an endpoint that the developer defines. So I'm going to go back into, to answer this question, I'm going to go back into the Gimbal Manager, and I'm going to click on that server rules link. Okay, so we're looking at Hello Gimbal iOS. What you're seeing here is that I had created several versions of that application on this account with the same title. That generally wouldn't be the case, but I'll describe what these rules are to you regardless. So with this, let's look at the last rule. There's four rows in this table. The last one I'm going to click on is probably the latest. What this is saying is anytime we see a beacon in this app that we own, go ahead and send me an event when the first time I see it, anytime I see it, within 420 seconds, which is 7 minutes, send me another event. And then when I don't see it anymore for 6 minutes, send me another event that says I am no longer in proximity to that beacon, to a URL that you would define right here in this citing callback URL. So what this would be, we would generate a JSON representation of the event, which is available on our documentation, the actual specification there, what that JSON looks like, and we would send it to the URL that you would put into here. Okay, so we're looking at this rule, and I tried to describe what it was doing. In reality, if you have a mobile application, you're getting those events on the device, and this may not be extremely useful to you. the reason these exist for the most part is we have hardware that we supported in the past that did not have the ability to have the events delivered to the physical hardware. So we would only be able to deliver them via server call. So I hope that answered that question. Did not necessarily apply to the demonstration that we were doing today. And as of right now, that looks like the last question on the Q&A.
Yeah, we can do a quick last call for questions.
Yeah. I didn't mention, but it may have been obvious. The developer account is free. Using Gimbal is free up until a certain number of users that's in the fee table. The only thing, you know, if you wanted to use the beacons, you have to purchase those. Everything else to do what we just demoed today is at no cost to the developer up front.